series. So before everything else, do you know what day it is besides our well-awaited lecture series? It is, let me hear it from you.
Happy Chinese New Year, everyone.
Woohoo! Yeah, that's right. Yong Hei Hua Chai, everyone. We hope you're all having a pleasant day. With that, the lecture will officially begin in 5 minutes. In order to have a smooth and efficient flow of events, please take note of the following announcements and house rules that will be presented later on the screen. Thank you. So, G, are you excited to learn something new today?
Of course I am, Rachel. I am an IS student, so I'm always excited about learning new things every day.
I am an IS student too. Well, say no more, because this lecture series is sponsored by the Department of International Studies. Our Bachelor of Arts in International Studies program is among the few schools that offer specialized tracks in international politics and global development studies, with emphasis on gender, peace, and human rights. Our curriculum prepares the students to pursue careers in local, national, and international agencies and organizations, as well as in the government and the private sector. We have two tracks under the Department of International Studies, namely International Politics, minor in Peace Studies, and Global Development, minor in Gender Studies.
The Master of Arts in International Studies program seeks to deepen the understanding of new theoretical developments, emergent complexities, and issues linked to globalization. It focuses on global governance, practices in international affairs and relations. Graduates of this program will be academically and technically prepared to be facilitators of social change, aided by global, regional, local perspective, knowledge, and analytical skills.
So, what are you all waiting for? If your children, siblings, friends, or relatives are interested in studying international relations and knowing more beyond borders, do not hesitate to register or enroll them under International Studies in Miriam College.
Please take note of the following house rules. Please make sure that your microphone is on mute at all times. You are encouraged to turn on your cameras if possible. Please be reminded that the lecture series will be recorded. Please make sure that your Zoom name is the name you have registered in the registration form. For questions for the speaker, kindly address in the chat box, or you can personally message the host for today and fill out the Q&A form to be presented later during the 10-minute break. And if you have any concerns, you may privately message Ms. Pearl Torres or Ms. Carissa Arambolo. And with this, do not forget to sit back, relax, and enjoy the first part of our lecture series.
And now, let us begin and hype up our event to a good start. Are you ready, guys, on our little activity? Well, I hope you all are, because I am. Here we have a whiteboard where you can express your thoughts and ideas on the question presented in front of your screens by writing or drawing it on your sign using your annotate tools. For those who wish to know how to use your Zoom's annotate feature, we will be posting on how to use them on our chat box. The question for today is, what are you looking forward to in this lecture series? So, what are your thoughts about this? Feel free to share it in whichever way you want on our whiteboard. So here we have our first word, knowledge. What can you say about that, G?
Well, surely knowledge is what we're aiming to gather today from Dr. He's presentation.
Yes. We also
I can see the word excited here.
Yes, and another one, get various perspectives on the topic. The concept of regionalism.
Oh,
awareness as well.
See the word awareness in the Indo-Pacific region, and we're gonna figure that out later on.
Yes. Insightful discussions as well. We will be having that on our Q&A later. And also a deeper understanding on the region.
There's also one that said, get various perspective on this topic. Well, we will surely have those later.
Yes, of course.
Oh, there's someone
what
typing.
Do we have here?
There's someone typing. I think someone typing. What is this?
Issues in the region. That's a beautiful topic.
Are there any more words from our participants?
Do you have any more thoughts to share? Okay, we apologize to cut our activity short, but thank you for your interesting responses to our questions. With that, join us in solidarity for the opening prayer.
Tumayo po tayong lahat at sabay-sabay nating awitin ang pambansang awit ng Pilipinas. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Rachel.
Good afternoon to you as well, G.
And good afternoon to everyone. But Rachel, before we forgot, we should remember that some of us say good morning
when it's midnight.
As we are transcending boundaries through virtual realities. So everyone who is with us today may also have different time zones. So for that, let us reiterate ourselves. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everyone. It is with great pleasure that we welcome you all to Miriam College International Studies Department International Experts Lecture Series. I am G. Quintana.
And I am Rachel Maglonzo.
Your moderators for today's event. The objective of this lecture series is to understand the new regionalisms and their implication on the global order. Previously, on our International Experts Lecture Series, the Miriam College of International Studies Department were honored to invite such remarkable experts in the field of international relations. They help us understand more the foreign policies of selected states which are relevant to the Philippine foreign relations. So, are we all ready? Rachel, are you ready?
I am super pumped right now, G.
Well, it seems like everyone is at the edge of their seats to hear our first speaker for this series. And to that, without further ado, let us welcome and introduce our first speaker for this event.
Today, as we culminate the foreign policy lecture series, we will discuss another important foreign policy, the Indo-Pacific region, with none other than Dr. Baogang He.
But before we start, I would like to warmly welcome the presence of our guests in today's event. We have over 76 participants consisting of faculty and students from various colleges and universities. And Rachel, we have also participants from government and non-government organizations present with us this afternoon. So, how are all of you? Did you have your breakfast, lunch, or dinner yet? Well, I hope you are comfortable in your seats because we are very excited to be with you all today.
May I also request those who we have failed to recognize to kindly state your school or organization in the chat box for everybody to duly note your presence in the significant lecture. So let us check.
Well, I bet that we have participants from all over the Philippines and also participants from all over the world with us this afternoon or this morning or
thank you, G.
Or evening, wherever you are right now.
Thank you for that, G. And with that, welcome everyone and thank you for going all through your schedules to be with us in today's event.
And to formally commence this event, may I call on Dr. Melanie Reyes, Chairperson of Miriam College, Department of International Studies, for the opening remarks. Ms. Mel?
Thank you, G. and Rachel and Dr. He, our guest speaker for today's lecture. Mr. Kebart Likayan, our lead organizer of this International Experts Lecture Series, IPPS 102 New Regionalism class of IS third year students, our IS faculty and all our IS students from first year to fourth year, and to all our guests, a pleasant afternoon or morning or evening to all of you. Welcome to another set of our International Experts Lecture Series, this second semester of school year 2020-2021, commencing today until March 5 of 2021. Organized by the Department of International Studies of Miriam College, led by the class of IPPS 102 by Mr. Kebart Litaya. Our topic for today is very critical to all of us as students, academicians, scholars, and researchers of international studies. When we talk about Indo-Pacific, it is impossible not to touch on Asian regionalism and to a greater extent, the Asia-Pacific conceptualization of the region, where countries like Australia, India, Japan, and the USA have adopted Indo-Pacific strategy in their foreign policies. As I've mentioned in one of my previous remarks, and I quote, we should be very careful in examining the construct of this concept. Under what condition shall we use or shall we look at these terms in terms of geographical demarcations, political boundaries, economic ties? Or can we use our own interpretation of space or what Udayanda in the diplomat article coined as an imaginative space where which transcends both the geographical demarcations and political boundaries, end of quote. Hence, we might all be interested to know what kind of regionalism are we referring to in the Indo-Pacific concept? Is it really driven by security agenda vis-a-vis economic integration and cooperation? What could be a clear picture of the Indo-Pacific and how does it change or continuously change the regional cooperation in Asia? I hope after our discussion for today, we will have more or less a clearer view on what Indo-Pacific regionalism entails. We are almost 100 in this Zoom room, and joining us in this forum are the different representatives from various schools, universities, and agencies, such as the Office of the President, the Presidential Communications Operations Office, House of Representatives, the Department of Science and Technology, Philippine Air Force, Armed Forces of the Philippines, Cavite State University main campus, Shanghai International Studies University, China, Far Eastern University High School, Far Eastern University, National Teachers College, University of the Philippines, De La Salle College of St. Benilde, Easter College, San Beda University, Manila, Pats College of Aeronautics, Polytechnic University of the Philippines, International Studies Association, International Studies Society, UE Manila, University of the East, Polytechnic University of the Philippines, Pre-Medical Civic Society, Lyceum of the Philippines University, Ateneo de Davao University, Asia Pacific College, Philippine Army, Bukidnon State University, Angeles University Foundation, Sigaw ng Kabataan Coalition La Union, Ministry of Defense, Generic Engineering Technologies, Technological University of the Philippines, Manila, New Era University, University of San Carlos, Pamantasan ng Lungsod ng Muntinlupa, Trinity University of Asia, University of Santo Tomas, St. Louis University, Philippine Women's University, De La Salle University, Manila, and of course, Miriam College. Parang this is all the universities and colleges in the Philippines. Again, welcome to Miriam College and to the Philippines for those outside of our country. We hope to see you all again in our succeeding lectures. Maraming salamat po.
Thank you so much for an inspiring and welcoming speech, Dr. Mel Reyes. Dr. Reyes truly knows how to kickstart our event. And now, to formally introduce our guest speaker for today's lecture, may I call on Ms. Rachel Maglonso to share with us a little background on our speaker for today. Rachel, take it away.
Thank you for that, G. To introduce our first speaker, Dr. Baogang He is the Fellow of the Academy of Social Sciences in Australia, Alfred Deakin Professor, Chair in International Relations, School of Humanities and Social Sciences, Faculty of Arts and Education, Deakin University. He graduated with a PhD in political science from Australian National University in 1994. Dr. He has also become widely known for his work in Chinese politics, in particular, the deliberative politics in China, as well as in Asian politics covering Asian regionalism, Asian federalism, and Asian multiculturalism. Dr. He has also published 6 single-authored books, 1 co-authored book, 5 co-edited books, 81 international refereed journal articles, and 66 book chapters. His publications are found in top journals, including Science, British Journal of Political Science, Journal of Peace Research, Political Theory, Political Studies, and Perspectives on Politics. In addition, he also published 3 books, 18 book chapters, and 82 journal papers in Chinese. Dr. He has received numerous awards, including Mayor Prize by the APSA in 1994, the Regan Fassel Fellow in 2003, the W. Glenn Campbell and Rita Ricardo Campbell National Fellow at Hoover Institute in 2008, the Alfred Deakin Professorship, the highest honor awarded a Deakin in August 2016, and the Fellow of the Academy of Social Sciences in Australia in 2019. Dr. He has also held several honorary appointments and research fellowships at renowned universities, including Stanford University, University of Cambridge, Columbia University, Leiden University, Sussex University, and Zurich University. And with that, let us all greet Dr. Baogang He with a warm welcome. Good day, Dr. He.
Can you hear me? Hello. Can you hear
we
me?
We do, Dr. He.
Okay, thank you.
We can hear you.
Let me see. Thank you very much. Today is a kind of remarkable day for me. It's a remarkable day is that we literally have a telecommunication revolution happen now. So I'm on the middle of the way, driving from the Melbourne to Sydney. I'm in the car, so I give a lecture in the car. So it's for me, it's the first time I do that. But it's the first time the modern communication system enable me to do these kind of things. When you're driving, you can still deliver lectures. So my first apology is that this suddenly Victoria government announced that Melbourne will lock down in the next 5 days because Melbourne has just found five new COVID-19 new cases. So we have to drive in from Melbourne to Sydney today. So that is happened today. Now, right now I'm in the car. So I was assigned to give a job to talking about Indo-Pacific regionalism. So what I will do is I will highlight a few key points. Then after that, I open for QMAs. So let me first come to this term Indo-Pacific. This term Indo-Pacific come out recently. So first is kind of something like the 2014, Japan, the first to coin to the Indo-Pacific, develop Indo-Pacific strategy. Later, America, Australia adopted, in particular, American adopt Indo-Pacific strategy. So one very, very peculiarity about this term Indo-Pacific is about this kind of regional identity. So everyone, you know, I guess for you living in Philippines, you know this ASEAN that has been a center for regional development in Asia. So there has been constant discourse on the rising of the Asia, discuss on the Asia. So suddenly we have a kind of new term, Indo-Pacific. So if we look at these two, Indo-Pacific, suddenly the concept Asia disappear. Concept Asia was not in the Indo-Pacific. So this is a peculiar, it's very interesting phenomena. That shows some interesting kind of identity politics going on in the United States as well in Australia. So Australia has been kind of trying to engage Asia, but it's not part of Asia, but Australia tried to be a part of Asia. But the United States is a Pacific power, it's not an Asian power. So by adopt the term Indo-Pacific, so they no longer need to discuss whether they are part of Asia, but now they have a big Indo-Pacific strategy. So here it's very interesting, this kind of idea of Indo-Pacific is a one way for both United States and Australia to overcome this Asian discourse. So this is the first thing I would like to say about it. The second thing I think is this term Indo-Pacific. The idea of Indo-Pacific is it's very interesting. It's tried to, the key purpose is try to dilute it, influence of the China. If we're talking about the Asian region or Asia-Pacific regionalism, so China has been increased, become one of the dominant power. But if you add the Indo-Pacific, so immediately the Chinese influence will be diluted. So that is probably another purpose for America, Australia try to do. But of course we know that this is one of the great purpose for Australia as well, United States, Japan, is try to get India in. So that is a term Indo-Pacific that come in. So they try to establish the quadrilateral security dialogue. So that's the key term. So when we talk about this Indo-Pacific regionalism, so one very important question, do we regard the quadrilateral security dialogue forum as a regional institution? Is a new form of Indo-Pacific regionalism, or it is not? It is airline-based, is a new form of American-led airline system. Now, this is a really important issue for us, we need to ask. So let's just go look at my slides. So I discussed this, so far this slide discussed this variety of the regionalism in Asia. Everyone know, probably you know the ASEAN, the Philippines is one of the key partner actors. Then the ASEAN plus three. Then we have a variety of a different kind of regionalism. Can we go to the next slide? So what I do want to in my talk is really I want to address why we need to talk about this new regionalism strategy in the Indo-Pacific, in particular in this kind of great power rivalry between United States and the China in the 21st century. So one of the key issue when we talk about this regionalism, one fundamental question, as I said before, whether or not a quadrilateral security forum, that is United States, Australia, Japan, India, can they be regarded as a form of a regionalism? So what I try to argue is that they are not. They are a kind of airline-based international forum or organization. So what I try to say is that probably we can think about this Chinese form of the new Indo-Pacific regionalism that is going on. So in my talk, I will briefly highlight what are they, those what so-called Chinese-led new form of the regionalism. And then we were briefly talking about this is what are prospects of the Indo-Pacific regionalism. So next slide, please. So before we do that, we needed to make sure the theoretical underpins for the regionalism. So normally people accept the European standard, think the regionalism. When we talk about regionalism, we will kind of use European Union as a standard, as a benchmark. So you need a soup national organization that will beyond national sovereignty, then impose a region-wide the law policies. So that's why sometimes some European scholars will call it, this is a kind of universal theorized of that regionalism. So this kind of understanding is contested And increasingly, we have seen this people talking about there's a variety different way to regional buildings. So Asia, ASEAN in particular, developed its unique way to develop regional integration, regional cooperation. So ASEAN can be regarded as a set of regional cooperation, and it can be regarded as currently giving this Brexit. Then the Asian regionalism still going on. So ASEAN led the regional institutions still going on at a deeply. So that can be as a kind of alternative theorizing. Then one more, probably the one particular important issue, to what extent we can regard the Chinese-led regional organization, what can be regarded as a form of regionalism. I have writing a paper, I tried to spend one section, try to make arguments that probably we should accept that the Chinese-led regional building is also a form of regionalism. Next slide, please. So one of the, I will briefly discuss the three form of Chinese-led regionalism. One is this, the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Originally, this Shanghai Cooperation is largely is China and Russia led, and the main members are Central Asian state. So in 2016, so the Shanghai Cooperation Organization accept the Pakistan and India as a new member. So this is a significant development. What does that mean? That means Shanghai Cooperation Organization has evolved into a hybrid organization. That is not this regional organization, not only traditionally based on land, but also based on ocean. They including two India Ocean country, Pakistan, India, a part of organization. So that can be say as a sort of the Indo-Pacific regionalism, I would argue. That also can be seen as a Chinese preempted struck against American-led quasi-led dialogue, security dialogue forum. So before American-led allies and institutions consolidate, preempted struck first to get the India in. So if India is already a member of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, so then it will be difficult for United States to make institutionalized quadrilateral security dialogue in terms of a truly a regional organization. So next slide, please. So the another probably I think this if we're talking about this Chinese-led regional building is this China 16+1 forum. So the one of the in the last decades, one of the new phenomena in international relations, they're always talking about the ASEAN plus, like ASEAN plus one, ASEAN plus China, or ASEAN plus Japan, ASEAN plus Korea, or ASEAN plus three, ASEAN plus six, all are as a form of a new form of new regionalism in Asia. So China has copied this kind of formula, developed China Plus. Later on, I will talk about China ASEAN Plus China as another kind of sort of regional, a new form of regionalism. Here is the case, is kind of China plus that this is China and 16th century East European country. They form a new regional dialogue. So this year, China faced some setback. They will hold this 16 plus one summit this year. And but as the top leaders, several of the leading president, prime minister will not attend it, to it. So apparently, probably they are first on the Washington pressures. The second, maybe they saw this forum did not produce the concrete stuff. It's more kind of symbolic. So they will send a minister to attend. So, but this anyway, so this is another kind of forum that there's a Chinese region organization reach to this Pacific, more than, not only Indo-Pacific Ocean, into Atlantic. So next slide, please. So one of the most important issues, I think that is relevant to the Philippines, is this ASEAN plus China forum regarding this South China Sea. I show this a few photos here, a picture. So the currently ASEAN plus China, they have developed a variety of forum on the different kind of, in the different domain, like the issue deal with media, the issue with economical cooperation, financial cooperations, or even river management, or even civil society cooperations. So the one of the biggest issue is this regard to the South China Sea issue. So there's that's very impressive. There's so many things going on each year. So next slide, please. I would like to say this is the South China Sea issue. That's the biggest issue for Philippines. And so it has also become contested issues. It was an issue between China and some of the Asian claimant states like Philippines, Vietnam, Malaysia. Now at the moment, the issue already go beyond Asia itself. It has become an issue between United States and China. So what China want to do is in the great power rivalry, and China, relatively speaking, is still a weak power compared to America. So for a weak power tends to utilize or promote regionalism to make its power great, to make the power more, make its power more powerful. So China attempts to use ASEAN plus one regional formula to advance its cause. So here it's very important. So here's China is the ASEAN plus one with regard to South China Sea. But when it comes to the regionalisms, there's a variety of alternative proposal, like Kevin Rudd's idea of Asia-Pacific community. And he tried to develop this idea to including both United States, China, to managing regional conflict. And Harry Kinsinger, they developed idea of the Pacific community. Bob Hawke even also said clearly that China should take a lead to develop a multilateral organization to ease and manage South China Sea in 2016. But in the Bob Hawke's proposals, he will include the United States. United States should be a part of this new regional organization. So, Last, 2 years ago, December 1919, I went to Hainan. I was invited by China's National Institute of South China Sea study, gave a talk about regionalism. In our informal exchange, and to my great surprising, so Chinese are considered, they said, they are willingly to consider, invite United States and Australia to be an observer of this Chinese new initiative, that is ASEAN plus China regional forum regarding South China Sea. Next slide, please. So I think I skip over those detail, the issue, process, everyone know that. Next slides. Skip over. I think that the one of lessons China has and developed this DOC in, but then that is not binding. Now, one of the challenging issues today is ASEAN plus one regarding South China, whether we will make this new code of conduct binding. Next slide, please. So next slide. And I just go back early my remark when I was visiting this China National Institute of South China Sea. They told me that they want to make this code of conduct binding. They even suggest that they should, after the currently they are going to the three rating among those as a member plus China. Currently, I think is the first, second reading is finished. So they try to complete this year, but the Chinese, there was one of the director, Professor Hu, he told me it's very interesting. He's a kind of very, it's a very reform mind official scholar. He said that after that, the China as well as a country should go to the legislative process. That is, each parliament authorized that the pass this new code of conduct. So make it legally binding. So before that, I should also say that this China kind of in the historical always said that South China Sea is a bilateral. They refused to use a regional organization to discuss South China Sea. But in 2014, China made a significant progress. One is Xi Jinping talking about China China as a destiny of the China as a community of the common destiny. And also in 2014, Chinese Prime Minister Li Keqiang talking about the kind of two track, that is a dual track idea. So when come to the concrete territory sovereignty issue, then it's a bilateral discussion. But when come to the more general, broader issue regarding South China Sea, so China accept this regional approach. So since 2014, China kind of pay attention to use this regional institution to manage this South China Sea issue. Next slide, please. I think as this everyone knows that probably this arbitration issue, so I'll just skip over the let's just skip over that this side. Let's skip over that this new development. Next slide. So here is one of the issue is whether we will have agreement on the final South China Sea in this year. So China try push hard, try to kind of complete it. but there are always this COVID-19, the last year slowed down. And we don't know whether this COVID-19 will further become obstacle. Plus, not only the COVID-19, but also there's many other issues. So next slide. So the one of the issues, legal boundary issue, I already mentioned that. Just next slide. So here, let me just come back to this big issue. So this is, as I said, this Chinese-led Indo-Pacific regionalism can be seen as an instrument for Beijing to fighting against United States. So it is, we need to see this as a great power rivalry. So China, if we use Chinese official language, so that is they try to use this kind of this form of Indo-Pacific regionalism to deal with what they call the external forces. So by they talking about external forces, they refer to as their purpose China is doing is that so we. Some press will already engage SMs, and so there's no need for external forces to interfere. So this is something in the global contestation. China tried to use this Indo-Pacific regionalism to do something. So one critical question for us to consider today as well in the future. So probably we can say this is maybe a self-evidence assumption or hypothesis that is a Chinese-led regional organization. In order to make the Chinese-led regional organization workable, credible, Beijing need to take a leading example to follow the rule Beijing set up or promote. So that means Beijing has to taming its behavior, taming its policy. That means that Beijing has to become a self-constrained in certain areas, certain behaviors. So this is a hypothesis. And in the next few years, we need to watch the future events to test this hypothesis, whether it is true or whether it proves wrong. Next slide, please. So this led me to discuss alternative views. That's David Martin June. He actually was my former colleague at the University of Tasmania. He always, we always had a lot of coffee, chat a lot of different things. We hold a different view. And probably you will know from what I talk today is really different from what's his view. But I respect his intellectual insight, honesty, and the sharpness. So one of his intellectual sharpness is that he always told me that the Chinese South China policy is a divided and rule strategy. What is he called it is a salami slice its way to control South China Sea. So here is a different kind of evaluation, different interpretation. If we follow this salami metaphor, so we can see this what so-called China-led Indo-Pacific regionalism is another salami strategy. So let us discuss this issue in the Q&A. So probably I think the next slide, I think I finished my, is there any slides? No. So let me end up here. Let's discuss. I already raised several big issues for you to consider. We really enjoy, will be lucky to listen your comments, your views. By the way, I published a book, Contested Idea of Regionalism. When I published that book, I gave many lectures on the regionalism in Japan, Korea, China, and other Asian countries in Singapore. I learned a great deal from the students, so I'm looking forward to learn from you. Hi, Rishu, I turn to you now.
Thank you very much, Dr. He, for an enlightening, well-argued, and compendious presentation on the Indo-Pacific region. At this juncture, let us all have a short 10-minute break to freshen up and hydrate ourselves, which will be followed by the open forum. Kindly please come back after this break.
You may type your questions at the chat box with your name and institution, or you can privately message Ms. Rachel Maglonso so you can ask your speaker. You may also send in your questions through our Google Forms by scanning the QR code presented on your screens. And if you wish for your questions to be recognized along with your name, do not forget to include them in your forms and messages. Well, I bet most of you already have a handful of questions for our speaker. What about you, Rachel? Have you sent your questions?
Well, G, I have my own questions, but for now, let us offer the Q&A floor for our participants.